And their wonderful worship team is going to provide some power-packed worship, hallelujah, to get you going this morning. Isn't Jesus wonderful? Hallelujah. Is he worthy of praise and worship? Amen. You know, Psalm 133 says, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down the beard of Aaron, even Aaron's beard, and went to the skirts of his garment as the dew of Hermon, as the dew descended upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore." Hallelujah. Amen. We're blessed today. Let's worship the Lord. He's worthy. Let's give him praise. Amen. Let's lift the roof. Lift the roof, he's worthy. Glory to Jesus, amen. Hallelujah.
Take my So
Amazing. Praise God. Hallelujah. So wonderful to enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So welcome here this morning again. Praise God. Our second day of the Northern Ireland Global Hub Summit. Hallelujah. We had a rich day yesterday. How many of you were blessed? Praise God. Tremendous word, tremendous training. Praise God. And I trust that God is speaking to you and he's speaking to each one of us. Hallelujah. God is just always taking us deeper. You know, I had a thought the other day. You know, if we had a time-lapse movie of our lives, just moving quickly through our lives, we would see that God was always taking us further and higher and faster. You know, you always see the movement of God in your lives. You know, and God is always bringing us up. He's always developing us. He's always pruning us. He's always helping us to bear more fruit for the kingdom. But it's the stills and it's the slow motion that kind of gets us at times, isn't it? You know, when you're just looking at the still photographs of your life and you're thinking, why don't I have movement here? But God's always moving. Amen. He's always working. Praise. He's always taking us higher. I remember one exhortation from a preacher from a long time ago. Some of you might remember him. His name was R.W. Shambach. And one of his famous lines was, "You don't have any problems, preacher. All you need is faith in God." Amen. That was one of his favorite. That just shook everybody to the core and put your eyes back on Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Well, we're giving an introduction again to the Global Church Network. Some of you weren't here yesterday, and so we're going to show a video again. The Global Church Network was founded by Dr. James Davis, praise God, and Dr. Bill Bright. Way back, just over 20 years ago, hallelujah, and the Lord had given them a vision for 1 billion souls, amen, 1 billion souls, and 5 million new churches, praise God, 5 million new churches for a global harvest. And so the Lord just began to deal with them about how to bring this about. And they knew that they had to help the body of Christ synergize relationships. That means, you know, just build relationships between key leaders all over the world. Hallelujah. And not only that, but then also with those leaders and in consultation with those leaders, over 10,000 leaders have helped to put together some of the best training in the body of Christ in the world. Praise God. 10,000 leaders have come together to help put all of this Global Church Divinity School together to systemize the training, praise God. And then they agreed to share wisdom and research and to strategize, how do we finish the Great Commission together? How do we finish the Great Commission together? You know, and it's absolutely been powerful. I told you yesterday that there's over, they have a new method of translating the Bible into unreached people group languages, developed by the Global Church Network, funded by the Global Church Network, and they have translated the Bible now into over 700 unreached people group languages. Praise God. And they're targeting the hardest 3,000 unreached people groups in the world. And they have exponentially, you know, sped up that process. Praise God. And we saw yesterday how they're working around the world again, strategizing. You know, it's over 2,700 denominations, ministries, organizations, associations, all come together, praise God, and over 700,000 churches, and how they're targeting different regions of the earth. And we can all be involved in that. We're all part of that. Amen. Right here as the hub in Northern Ireland, we've sent £6,000 just as a gift to the Mount Everest Training Center there in Nepal, praise God, at 8,000 feet to train laborers, church planters, to go through the 10,000 villages in the Himalayan mountains. They call it the overground church. We've always heard about the underground church. We haven't heard about the overground church that wasn't reached. Praise God. And Dr. Davis went and he spoke with the local leaders there and he said, I want to go. He's always a goer. He's always a networker. He said, I want to go to the highest church, the highest church that you have here in the Himalayas. They said, you can't. He says, no, you don't understand. I want to go. He said, I'm ready. I'll go. They said, you can't. And he said, oh, please, you know, I want to go to the world's highest church, highest altitude. And they said, okay, you'll last about 3 minutes. Because it was like 20-something thousand feet or something. You know, it was like crazy. There's no oxygen up there. And you have to be acclimatized to it. But this is the vision and the heart of the Global Church Network, and we're going to go ahead and watch one of their videos here to introduce the Global Church.
Jesus said to go and make disciples of all the nations. For 2,000 years, the church has worked to complete his Great Commission to us. In 2002, Dr. Bill Bright and James O. Davis, two visionaries from different streams of Christianity, said, what if the global church could get into a position to complete the Great Commission in one generation? What if pastors globally could talk, teach, study, and learn together without having to switch tribes or lose their own identities? What if we could help synergistically to plant 5 million new churches for a billion soul harvest? In 2002, the first Global Church Pastors Conference was held in Orlando, Florida, with 5,000 leaders from all major streams of Christianity worldwide. In 2005, 500 global leaders from 71 nations convened at the Global Church Planting Congress in Dallas, Texas. They agreed to share relationships, resources, research, recommendations, and reports. For the next 5 years, leaders convened in billion soul summits around the world. More than 10,000 overseers, leaders, elected officials, missionaries, leading evangelicals, evangelists, and fellowships met face-to-face to discuss future goals. Together, they set collective goals toward the greater goal of planting 5 million churches for a billion soul harvest. In November 2019, 14 years later, the Global Church Network surpassed the goal of helping plant 5 million new churches and to win 1 billion souls to Christ. After meeting with major leaders in every region on earth, Leonard Sweet, Kenneth Olmer, and James O. Davis developed 7 points of knowledge that every Christian leader in the world needs: preaching, teaching, healing, story, the arts, Christ formation, and contextual semiotics. Today, a global faculty from every world region has created courses in this module. Systematic stages from novice to mentor can help train pastors and leaders throughout the world. Since 2002, the Global Church Divinity School has helped train tens of thousands of pastors worldwide. The Global Church Divinity School features a global church library where the greatest works of Christianity reside, with thousands of resources available online. Global church authors, publishers, and denominations are donating their works. The mighty reservoir of the Global Church Divinity School continues to distribute this wealth of resources through the internet, the global hubs of Christianity, and in print. After more than 20 years of research and development, after conducting conversations with more than 15,000 leaders from around the world, after helping plant 5 million new churches and win 1 billion souls to Christ, after the deployment of more than 120 hubs, the more than 200 co-chairs in the Global Church Network are moving forward to finish the Great Commission. On November 1st, 2017, at the gravesite of Martin Luther in Castle Church, Wittenberg, Germany, the Global Church Network launched Finish 2030, the completion of the Great Commission by the 2000th birthday of the Church. A Finish declaration was written and sent to every major denomination worldwide. The Finish acronym, written by Dr. Timothy Hill, General Overseer of the Church of God, is Find, Intercede, Network, Invest, Send, and Harvest. GCN is committed to finding the remaining unreached people groups and translating new Bible languages in its hubs, interceding 1 billion prayer hours in this decade, networking like never before, investing time, energy, and money, sending the best equipped young ministers, and bringing in the harvest. In January 2022, groundbreaking took place for the first ever Mount Everest Training Center at the 8,000 foot level in the heart of the Himalayan mountains. In the years to come, thousands of church planters and leaders will be equipped to plant churches in the highest altitudes in the world. While the GCN is committed to equipping the underground church, GCN is also committed to training the upper ground church. Dr. James O. Davis, founder of the Global Church Network, is often asked, "Do you believe it is possible to complete the Great Commission in our lifetime?" His answer remains the same. "This is the only lifetime I have. Why would I consider anything else?" Completing the Great Commission is within reach of this generation. We must seize the moment. When the rate of evangelism exceeds the rate of population growth, we will do something that has never been done before. The Global Church Network will be positioned to reach the entire world with the gospel. Pastors will be trained and ready. Churches will be planted and opened. The world harvest will be brought in, and we will synergize together, one person at a time, until the Great Commission is completed.
Amen. Praise God. Can we go ahead and show the Global Church Divinity School video also, please?
The Global Church Divinity School houses hundreds of online courses taught by world-class Christian leaders from every world region and every major stream of Christianity. The GCDS online campus is comprised of 20 state-of-the-art virtual buildings, each with a unique academic focus or ministry purpose, named after a key leader in the Global Church Network. The Global Church Divinity School has brought together the finest minds to provide the best teaching to pastors and leaders in the 21st century. The church is no longer going from the West to the rest of the world, but the best around the world going to the rest of the world. The main architects of the Global Church Divinity School, James O. Davis, Leonard Sweet, and Kenneth C. Ulmer, have synergized their knowledge, wisdom, and experience to create a fresh, dynamic learning paradigm designed to impact the entire body of Christ. The Global Church Classroom provides a cutting-edge environment for individualized courses, community cohorts, and face-to-face learning taught by key Christian leaders from around the globe. The curriculum is comprised of 7 ministry training tracks, each with 7 levels of learning, for a total of 49 learning modules available to each student. The 7 ministry tracks are preaching, teaching, healing, story, the arts and imagination, Christ formation, and contextual semiotics. The 7 levels of learning within each track are novice, apprentice, specialist, docent, maven, master, and mentor. While the courses within each ministry track do not have to be taken in a specific order, all 7 levels of learning are required to complete the track. Each student can earn a maximum of 8 prestigious credentials issued by the Global Church Divinity School Board of Governors. The crowning credential, Omega, is only issued after all the ministry tracks have been fully completed. The Global Church Divinity School has been shaped through the lens of servicing the local church. There are 4 membership levels: Growth, Gold, Grand, and Global, with each building upon the other. The Growth membership equips one leader. The Gold membership enlists one church. The Grand membership encourages up to 10 churches. And the Global membership expands up to 50 churches. Whether you're seeking training for yourself, your church, your region, or your missional world, there is a perfect membership for you.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Just to let you know again, you can sign up for the Global Church Divinity School. It's free of charge to those who attend the hubs, and you can make this available to your congregations as well and encourage them to come to the hubs. But the registration table out there will take your name and your email address, and we will send you login details. You can begin this wonderful journey. There's over 1,000 hours of teaching, absolutely incredible. And some of the greatest people on earth really, really teaching this. I know, you know, Jesus is our head and everything, but for the Bible says, to whom honor is due, give honor. You know, there's Suliasi Kurulo in Fiji. They've started over 7,000 churches with their ministry training programs, leadership development, missionary outreaches. Absolutely incredible. David Mohan, head of the Assemblies of God in India, has over 40,000 in his church service every Sunday. They're building a 55,000-seat sanctuary just for Sunday morning. Hallelujah. You know, and Dr. David Subrapina, again, Assemblies of God there in the Philippines and in Manila, but they have over 73 satellite services for every single, you know, Sunday morning. And just they're all denominations involved: Southern Baptist, you know, Holy and Pentecostal Holiness, and Nazarene, and Methodist and Presbyterian. Praise God. We had lots of Presbyterians in our hub there in Cairo when we were in Cairo. It was absolutely incredible. So praise God. Yes, again, it's building relationships across the body of Christ. Praise God. It's all of us, you know, just encouraging each other in these wonderful training opportunities, you know, and hearing testimonies. You know, when people like Dr. David Moe, or Dr. David Subrapina talks about God giving him the money supernaturally, you know, giving him the money for a 12,000-seat sanctuary there in Manila, on a property that was about $2 million worth when their income was only 10,000 pounds a month, you know, and just supernaturally putting that in his hands, and he gives the testimony. It's incredible. It just inspires you. You know, the testimonies of great leaders, just people that have done great things around the world, just inspire all of us. Hallelujah. So I encourage you to sign up. And also, the Global Church Divinity, the Global Church Network has an app. Praise God. You can download that to your phone, and you can access the Global Church Divinity School through your phone, and you can see also the regional conferences that they have. We just returned from the European conference. We'll talk about that later. Praise God. But it's all available to you. It's absolutely wonderful. We have our first session here this morning. Praise God. Mitch, everyone knows Mitch. Amen. Praise God. Crown Jesus Ministries. Hallelujah. A man of God with passion. Praise God. Such wonderful creativity in the way that they do outreach, you know, right across Ireland, north and south. The south of Ireland is one of the greatest mission fields that there is. Praise God. And Mitch, you're a legend in networking as well. Praise God. We just want to welcome you this morning. Amen. Helping to stir all of us to evangelism in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Nice to be with you this morning. Nice to be back in Green Pastures. The title I've been given this morning is The Great Commission, and we're going to be looking at the Great Commission today. Interesting, the last time, Jeff, I spoke in Green Pastures was 6 years ago, May 6 years ago, and the title was The Great Commission. So there's two things going on there, or one of two things. One is God's really speaking to us, or two, I only have one topic. One of those two, isn't it? 1 Peter chapter 2, this is what it says. It says that we are a chosen generation. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're chosen. You're chosen. You're chosen. Before the foundation of the earth, you're chosen. It says we're a chosen generation. Then what does it say? It says we are a royal priesthood. Like there's priesthood, then there's royal priesthood. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're royal. Royalty. We need to walk like we're royalty a little bit. Sometimes Christendom, we walk like we've got a poverty mentality. But we're chosen and we're royal. And then you need to dip into the King James for the next one. It says, we're a peculiar people. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're peculiar. Why? We're getting more peculiar. I'm not shy about that. The modern translations move the word, change the word peculiar to the special, but it means more than that. It means more, yes, we're special, but it also means that we are distinctly different. We're not like everybody else. We're not going to behave like everybody else with the mantle of God on us. And so when we come to the topic, the Great Commission, it's always important that we know our identity before we move into the commission, that we know that we are chosen, royal, and peculiar. Allow me a moment just to get my notes set up. But while I do that, why don't you just have a conversation with the person next to you for a moment and ask them the question, what comes into your mind when you hear the word Great Commission? So, for example, if I said to you the word chocolate, what comes into your mind? Cadbury's. Everybody got a favorite? Who's a Cadbury's fan? Who's in the like galaxy? Who will take chocolate, whatever way it comes? Yeah, good. Or if I say the word strawberry, what comes into your mind? Cream. If I say the words Great Commission, what comes into your mind? Turn to your neighbor, have a conversation. I get my notes set up. I would be interested in hearing what those thoughts are. You know, whether when you think of the word, the words Great Commission, Do you think of something that is a responsibility for you, or is a responsibility for someone else? Do you think it's all over there in the 1040 window, or do you see that it's something that happens local? Hopefully, by the end of this 2-hour session, you'll have a bit of a handle on that. I've been given a timeline this morning. It's to finish at 11:30. I will do my very best to do that. The notes that I have been given this morning are the notes from James Hudson Taylor IV, the great grandson of the renowned missionary who took the mission of God to China. Hands up if you've heard of Hudson Taylor before. Amazing, an amazing story. And many people who know me know that I love church history. And one of the books I actually have is over 100 years old. It's a biography of Hudson Taylor. And the biography of Hudson Taylor, fascinating little bit of insight for those who love the impact of the 1859 revival, because the foreword for Hudson Taylor's biography is written by Grattan Guinness, Henry Grattan Guinness, who became a close friend of Hudson Taylor. Hudson Taylor went to China, and he was kicked out after 6 years, told he would never to return. And he was living in London, and this is now 1860. He's living in London, and he's in quite a low place trying to figure out what he's to do next. And the year before that, the 1859 revival had landed here in Ballymena, and from Ballymena hit throughout Ulster and beyond. And in the summer of 1859, they had three missions in Botanic Gardens. The first one, the Reverend Hugh Hanna from Berry Street Presbyterian, pulled the folk together. It was 20,000 people gathered. And the next one, he invited Henry Grattan Guinness to come. And he came in July, and then they sent a telegram to a name you will all be familiar with, Charles Haddon Spurgeon. And Spurgeon came in August, 40,000 people gathered in Botanic Gardens. He's put them into small groups to pray. And that's one of the significant momentums of the 1859 revival. But Henry Grattan Guinness was deeply impacted by the 1859 revival, went and spent time with Hudson Taylor. And Hudson Taylor says in his biography, he writes these words. It says, to understand the fruitfulness and significance of this period, it should be borne in mind that Mr. and Mrs. Taylor, among others, were reaping the aftermath of the great revival of 1859. And when they went out, back out to China, they went out with an anointing, an authority, and a power that was multiplied, not only in China, but into even the mission of God today. So thankful for that little parallel between the Guinness family, and he's the grandson of Arthur Guinness, who founded Guinness. So the Guinness family, the Ulster Revival, and Hudson Taylor, little connections. They warm our heart. If you're an Irish in here, it's nice to know we had a connection. We had some part to play in what happened in the ministry of Hudson Taylor. So you have that little note there. His notes have been edited today by me just to add some of my own commentary. So on the screen there, you'll see that. Put my little note in there as well, if you want to pop it up there, brother. So Mitch, I put mine in there beside it. B-A-B-D stands for born again, but doubtful. I'll let that drop in. And I don't have the same category of history of Hudson Taylor. I put at the bottom there Mitch's grandfather. Well, my grandfather was an elder in the Presbyterian Church, and he was also a member of the UVF, if you know what that is. So you can work that out. Mitch, who am I? I'm an evangelist, and I identify as a man. So a little bit of tongue-in-cheek kind of set us up for the day. So I'm not of the same caliber of history as Hudson Taylor, but I do want to come and encourage you today. We've got 7 parts to these notes. There were 12 parts in the notes that I was given, which is 47 slides. I would rather be raptured than sit through 47 slides. So I've cut that down to about 46. No, I haven't. I've got it down to about 20-something slides today. Summarized, condensed the essentials of what Hudson Taylor wants to bring, and supplemented that with some of my own thoughts and reflections. Part one is a good foundation for the Great Commission, a good foundation for the Great Commission. And I want to give some thoughts and reflections on this before we look at not only the Great Commission, but the 4 and possibly 5 commissions that Jesus gave to his church. And the foundation for this is John chapter 9, verse 4 and 5. If you've got a Bible with you, you open it up. Need a bigger pulpit, Jeff. Or maybe just a smaller Bible. John chapter 9 and verses 4 and 5. This is what it says. I must work the works of him who sent me. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And then in Luke chapter 5, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Luke chapter 5. I'm going to read verses 1 right through to 11. And so it was when the multitude pressed around him, being Jesus, to hear the word of God. And he stood at the side of the lake of Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the side of the lake. But the fishermen were gone from them, for they were washing or mending their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and he asked him to pull out a little bit from the land. And he said to him, he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a great catch. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down my net. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners, the other boats, to come and help them. And when they came, they filled their boats so that they almost began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord. Then he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish. And so were the sons of James and John and Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, do not be afraid. From now on, you will catch men. So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all, and they followed him. As we go into the mission of God today, the commission of God, there are some very helpful points that we could draw out of both of these texts. The first one is the sense of teamwork with the Lord Jesus. There's a real sense of we in what is going on here. This is not an assignment where it is left to Jesus or left to his Holy Spirit, but it is something that we do with God. It's a partnership. I like the idea that in the co-mission, there's a co-mission. There's a co-mission. We do this together. There's a great phrase, teamwork makes the dream work. And you see the teamwork in the two boats, but you also see the teamwork in Jesus saying, we must carry out this great mission. And there's an urgency because he said that the darkness is coming. There is a day of darkness coming in that Luke chapter 9, but we live in the days of light because Jesus is the light of the world and we have him in us and working through us. But there's some great illustrations and thoughts in around this whole idea of Jesus calling these disciples to be fishers of men. Some little notes in that Luke chapter 5 that helped us to land into the Great Commission. The first thing is this. Jesus is standing on the beach. If you've ever had the privilege of being in Israel, it's a kind of a zigzagging shoreline. And Jesus is standing on the beach, and it says there's a great multitude have gathered around him. We don't know what that looks like, but probably around 200 to 300 people have pressed in around him on the beach. That's kind of looking at the numbers of the people who lived in Capernaum at that time and the local villages. Kind of 200 to 300 people pressing around him. And here's the problem. When a bunch of people are in close, your voice doesn't carry very well. Even if you're Jesus. Even if you're George Whitefield, your voice doesn't carry well when people are pressed around you. So what does Jesus do? Jesus sees two boats. He takes one of the boats. He takes it out from the side of the shoreline, maybe out 30 or 40 feet. And what does he do in that moment? He creates a natural amphitheater so that his voice can be heard by everyone. I mean, it's genius in one sense, isn't it? And in the other sense, it's common sense. What does Jesus do in that moment that all of us can learn from? He uses the natural landscape of what's in front of him, the readily available boat, and he maximizes the opportunity. You see, we need to step into that today when it comes to the commission of Jesus, of going out. We need to look at what's the natural geographical landscape, what's the culture that we face today, and what's the readily available book. One of them could be, of course, social media. Social media has the potential to be your window on the world, doesn't it? It's got the potential. That would be using something that's readily available. And I think what we can learn from this is that we've got to be smart. We've got to be a little bit smart in terms of, like, there are many ways, and we'll cover later on about methodology and evangelism and the gospel, but there are many ways to do it. And we can't just think that there's one way, because if we think there's one way, we're going to be very narrow on our focus. Of course, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. But note in that passage, Romans chapter 1, verse 16, what does it say? I'm not ashamed of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. What is the power of God unto salvation? Gospel. Not the preaching of the gospel. The power is not in the preacher. The power is not in the methodology. The power is in the gospel itself. Can I hear a good amen in here? It's the gospel itself. And so that's the kernel of our faith, that we understand what the gospel is and we handle that with integrity. And the methodology is rich and diverse beyond that. Rick Warren said one time, methods are many, principles are few. Methods change often, but the principles never do. I like that. It rhymes. It helps me to remember it too, isn't it? Methods are many. Puppets, tracts, preaching. Methods are many. Principles are few. The gospel. 7 key components of the gospel. Methods change often, but the principles never do. Up on the screen there, I have those. Just keep those up, brother. Jesus is inviting us to work with him. There is an urgency in the command. There's a risk. You know, there's a risk in evangelism. That's why most people don't do it. But the risk is a true one. Jesus said, like, you will get persecuted. Suffering will come. Paul tells the stories of being shipwrecked, beaten. It just comes with it. Sometimes people confuse that with other things, but there is persecution and suffering that comes with the faith. That does not dismiss the idea that God is a healing God, that God wants to protect his people, not for one second. But the promises of God is that trouble comes with it. We shouldn't be afraid of that. That's what you should sign up for. I remember hearing many years ago, Billy Graham made an invitation. I think it was in Indiana at a football stadium, and many people came forward. And as they were coming forward, Billy Graham asked them to stop and to go back to their seat. He said, I want to make sure you understand the cost, that there's a cost in following Jesus. And then made the altar call for a second time. He didn't want people to think that this was just a nice little club that you join up to, you know, I've messed up, you've messed up, God loves everybody, Jesus died for our mess. If we say thank you, we can have a home in heaven, eternal life. Like, that's a kind of a fluffy gospel, isn't it? No sense of repentance in there. No sense of, like, you know, the resurrection of Jesus and the power and the anointing that comes through that. We can't give a fluffy gospel. We have to be true to the gospel. And when we're true to the gospel, there's a risk that comes with that. Am I speaking too fast? All right. I'm not sure whether you can because I'm speaking too fast or whether you just feel like you need to keep your hands warm. And this partnership is needed. I love this moment that he says, the boat is sinking. Go and get my friend's boat. Like, they got together. I can't emphasize enough in 30 years of evangelism how important partnership works. Like, why do we not see much more partnership between churches? Why do we not see more partnership between ministries? And it frustrates me that's the small thing, isn't it? It's the small thing. Oh, you know, and we get a little bit egoistic. Ego, E-G-O, edging God out. Our church is better than their church. They don't really understand evangelism. We're way ahead of them. Like, there's no sense of humility in that. If you want to have a revival in your church, like, one of the things that you need to do, I was with that Zach a couple of weeks ago from the Asprey revival, and he said, you must crush your ego. You must crush your ego. You need to contend for revival and prayer. You need to create space, carved out space for God to move. And you must crush your ego. See, when I say I was with Zach from the Asprey Revival, hands up who's heard of Asprey? Hands up if you've heard of Zach before. One person. But like it was Zach that pretty much led that revival from the first day. Because he wasn't interested in making a name for himself. He didn't even use his second name. I can't even remember his second name. Because they didn't want ego to get in the way. This is the guy behind the revival. And when the stars came to Asprey Revival, and they did come, stars in terms of movie stars, but also in Christendom, they said, there's another room for you. This room is just for the students. This little capacity in here is 1,100 students. But we're really glad you came. There's another like space that you can go into, and you're very welcome. There was one well-known evangelist came and said, I'd like to come and share a word. It's not this revival. We need to crush our ego, and we do that. When we do that, partnership is very potent in the mission of God. Very potent. Okay, just moving on. Part two is, what is the Great Commission? What is the Great Commission? Well, the first thing I want to mention here is that Jesus never talks about a Great Commission. In the New Testament, there is no mention of a Great Commission. What you do see is four, arguably five, commissions of Jesus. Why do I say arguably five? Because the Mark 16 passage, there's some dispute around that because it's highly likely that Mark did not write that. Now, that doesn't give me too much trouble because what is in that passage in Mark 16 looks like what they've seen in the early church. So if it was supplemented later on, I have no fear of that. And listen, that's an appendices, another sermon for another day. But I have no fear of the Mark 16 passage being there, as long as we're aware that we handle it with like good critique of theology and say, highly likely that Mark didn't write that. It doesn't look like the rest of the writings of Mark. But we shouldn't be afraid of that being there. The other four are very clear messages from Jesus. So let me just kind of summarize quickly some of what is said in those texts. Matthew 28, 18 and 19, which is referred to as the Great Commission, is one of the commissions. And this is what it says. Jesus came to them and said, all authority on heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, and go and make disciples of all nations. Everybody say all nations. All right. For God so loved the whole world, not a little bit of it. The whole world. Repentance, Luke 24, 47. The second one, the repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations. Everybody say all nations. Beginning in Jerusalem. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Thank you. The Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and on to the ends of the earth. All nations, ends of the earth. And then in John 20, 21, if I have a favorite, I guess this may be it. Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. What do we learn from all of those four commissions? And indeed, if we included the Mark 16 one, it would be exactly the same as the being sent out. What do we learn? That we are the sent ones, and who are we sent to? We're sent to the all nations. We go with the full authority of Jesus to all nations. The panta ten ethne is the Greek for that. And a little footnote on that, it's on the screen. By the way, if you want to reach out to me afterwards, I'm happy to give you the slides and keep, you know, taking photographs and stuff. It's a bit of a hassle. I can email them to you. There's no problem. We go in the full authority and the anointing of Jesus. Let's press pause on that, first of all, that you get that. We go in the full authority. Jesus said, John 20, 21, a picture like as if I'm Jesus and you're the disciples. He's going to send you out on a mission. And his first words to you are, peace. Oh, it's good he said that, wasn't it? Like, it was good it was his first word. It wasn't his last word. Because it's pretty scary out there. The wolves aren't wearing sheep clothing anymore. The wolves are right in your face. And I love it that he said, peace. And then, as the Father sent me, I'm sending you. And then he breathes on them. I have a coffee breath this morning. You won't want me to breathe on you, right? But he breathes on them. And it's the Ruach of God. This is the same idea of in Genesis, where God bends down and breathes into the nostrils of Adam, into the dust, and he brings Adam to life. And this is what's happening in the commission of God, is that God breathes into us his Holy Spirit. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. If you don't get goosebumps about that, I question your salvation. Like, that's amazing. And then we know from Acts 10, verse 38, says this, how did the Father send the Son? How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. That's how he sends us. And that one actually is not the one that everybody calls the Great Commission. Point being, people, I think all the commissions are great. Even in Mark 16, 1. I think they're all great. And so we have to be careful that we don't handpick one. But we also have to be careful in this reading of this point I'm making here. Just continue with it. Is Jesus said, all nations, the panta ethne. Some of us, what does this mean? Some people think that it only means the unreached groups of this world. Let me be clear in this. And John Piper actually backs this idea up. He holds all of the commission together with the missionary ventures in Acts and Paul's letters. And it is clear as day. Where are we to go? We are called to all people everywhere. No one has left out, even the Irish. Are we good with that? It's very dangerous if we think that the commission is just all over there. Everybody needs to hear the gospel. And I heard an evangelist say one time, he said, no one should have the privilege of hearing the gospel twice until everyone on the earth has heard it once. Has anyone heard that idea before? That's rubbish. I thank God somebody put up with me and had to tell me 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 times. I probably heard the gospel 100 times before I came to Christ. So never get this idea that we just go to like unreached people or people who have never heard the gospel. Because here's the problem, and there's lots of this in Ballymena. Pastor Jeff will vouch for this. There's lots of people who have a form of godliness but denied the power. There's a lot of people who have heard the gospel or parts of the gospel, but they haven't got the fullness. So let's not be shy about sharing the gospel. And the all nations starts right here. It starts in our neighborhood. And then, do you know what? It's beautiful in this moment that we live in, that the nations of the world are so, they're everywhere. Last week, with our team in Crown Jesus, we went into all 32 counties of Ireland in 1 week and shared the gospel. We did evangelism in every county in Ireland in 1 week. People came to faith every single day. In schools, on the street, men's curry nights. Love those. If you want to host one, I'll be happy to come speak at it. At ladies' events, all kinds of places. Because there's an openness to the gospel. And there was people came to faith who were from Nigeria. There was people who came to faith who were from Tipperary. There were people who came to faith from all kinds of places. The gospel is for everybody. Does that make some sense? Right. Part two, following on. The challenge of reaching the unreached, this idea of the 10-40 window. I want to cover some stuff in these slides quite quickly. Again, if you want a copy of these slides, I can send them to you afterwards. 10-40 window is an area of North Africa and the Middle East and Asia between approximately 10 degrees and 40 degrees north latitude. It Christendom talks about, by the way, the 10-40 window. Talk about the 10-40 window in a non-Christian context. No one has a clue what you're talking about. Less than 2% of money and resources given to the Great Commission go to outreach in this part of the world. Less than 2%. I'm so thankful for our generous brothers and sisters in America who give the vast majority of the money to support mission in the 1040 window. So thankful for that. But I think we have to be very careful. And I can say this because I'm an Irish guy, I'm a Belfast guy, is we need to be very careful that we don't have a stingy culture in our churches. We got a stingy mentality when it comes to money. Like, we don't look to bless and resource. We always are withholding money. We give a little bit to that. Oh, we give a little bit to that. And, you know, our church, we give to 20 different ministries. Yeah, you give like £5 to each of them a month. Why not, like, just pick one and knock it out of the park? That there's a story to tell that Jesus is making a difference. We got a stingy culture when it comes to overseas mission. And I got to be careful because I'm a ministry. I don't want to sound like I'm jumping on a hobby horse. But we've got a stingy culture when it comes to local mission. A mission in general. I mean, if the three great things of the church are evangelism, discipleship, and worship. But I think they are. I mean, worship is our number one. The church exists for worship. The problem is we don't have them. So that's why we do discipleship and why we do evangelism. But the church exists for worship. But imagine if we carved out our budget for a church. Would it be radical if we carved out our budget and said one third of it is for discipleship, one third of it is for mission, one third of it is for evangelism and the mission of God, both home and overseas? I think we'd see a radical change in our culture and our churches. Oftentimes, we spend way too much on ourselves. A real danger of embezzlement, of spending money on ourselves instead of spending it on the mission of God. Less than 2% of money goes to the Great Commission. Next slide. Muslims, the largest unreached group in the world, 1.6 billion. 1.6 billion. One of the greatest challenges of the church in the 21st century. Consider, how do you take the gospel to Muslim people? How can we befriend and gain trust in this population? How can we share the message of hope in humble and loving ways? Can I recommend to you, there's some terrific books out there when it comes to engaging with the Muslim world. There's one good friend of mine, Andy Bannister. Andy Bannister spent 11 years in studying apologetics to a doctorate level on reaching the Muslim world. And he has some great resources online, some great videos, and a tremendous book on how we can have conversations with Muslims, how we can reach Muslims, how we can equip others. And also, we have to have the courage to go out. My nephew, very proud of him, he just got married 4 weeks ago to a girl from Boston. And they've decided to settle in Leicester. And I'm like, Leicester? In England? Why do you want to go and live in Leicester? He said, because of the density of Muslim communities that are in Leicester, and we feel a call of God that not necessarily to the 1040 window right now, but to go to the Muslim community in Jesus. So without any jobs and without any accommodation, they committed themselves to Leicester, and 2 weeks ago they got themselves a little apartment. I mean, that's going into the mission. We need to say an amen to that kind of thing. We need to support that kind of thing that people are doing. Muslims, the Chinese, the second largest unreached group, 1.3 billion in China alone. Many Chinese live, of course, outside of China. Consider how you can reach Chinese people with the gospel. You might sit and say, I have no idea. Well, let's go and figure it out. This is one of the things that we do, and forgive me, I'm a Pentecostal to the bone, but Pentecostals can be a bit complacent with this stuff. Sometimes we go, well, there's a great need here and a great need here and a great need here. But hallelujah, Jesus is going to save the world. Glory to God, amen. No, I get that there's salvation in Jesus alone. But go back to our first point. There's a work for us to do. Work. Like, work it out. Think of, like, an apologetic level for yourselves to even go, what's the two questions you would hate someone in work to come and ask you? Like those two big questions, it could be, Darren, why does the God of love allow suffering? And you'd be like, oh, any question but that one. Or it could be a question about 2S, LGBTQIAPKM, or something else. Well, then rather than spend your life running from the question, go and find the answer. I mean, there are answers out there. They may not be complete answers, but they will be answers that will help you on the journey of conversational evangelism with those around us. That makes some sense. It's the same for the Chinese. How do Chinese people think? Understand the culture. Buddhists, third largest unreached group in the world, 1 billion, residing in many parts of Asia, including Thailand and Hong Kong, Taiwan, Japan, and China. Consider this morning how you can take the gospel to our Buddhists. Again, with the Chinese and Buddhist community, there are places in Belfast, perhaps, in Ballymena, where there's a strong density of Chinese and Buddhist community. If you go to Donegal Pass in Belfast, there's a strong density of them, of that community. How do we reach them? What times of day do they hang out? Because it's different than us. What times do they eat? What do they enjoy doing? Would they be willing to go on the Alpha course? Probably not. But would they be willing to come to a glorious banquet? Some food, cultural food, and a conversation about truth. We've got to think outside of the box of how we reach Buddhists. Hindu, 700 million. Many Hindus live outside of India today. And then Irish is my slide. 5 million people live in the Republic of Ireland pre-famine, 1845. That was 8.5 million. So like that just gives it like even in 160, 70, 180 years, like we're still nowhere near what the population was because of the tragedy of the famine. Ireland is the most unevangelized English-speaking nation in the world. Yes, send our money to the 1040 window. But I get frustrated time and time again that we overlook that. That statistic is not one that's just like blowing up and made up. That's fact. Now, here's where you could put a dispute into it. You could put a dispute into that fact if you say, and there is a little case for this, that there is a sense of evangelization that can happen through mass. So if you say that evangelization can happen through mass, ignore that. If you say that that's slim, then that has some weight. Does that make sense? So I'm just being scholarly and honoring that statistic that for some Catholic people, they'll say, we disagree with that because we do feel there's an evangelization that does happen or can happen through mass. But if we set that to the side, that is a real fact. The Irish, 5 million pre-famine, most unevangelized English-speaking nation in the world. Go back to my slide, bro. Thank you. So Crown Jesus Ministries, that's a little moment for me to put an advert in. Is that okay? So Crown Jesus Ministries, that's where our heart is, to see the people of Ireland, north and south, crown Jesus, Lord of their lives. We have a mandate that by the end of this decade, everybody in Ireland will have the opportunity to hear and respond to the gospel. That means the gospel going to every school, the gospel going to every home. That means the gospel going on social media. That means raising up evangelists in every church. And that means uniting the church in prayer for lost people. If you believe in that, then I would love you to pray for us. I'd love you to stand with us. Here's a little glimpse. We're talking about, remember, the Great Commission is everywhere. Killorglin, Kilrush, County Offaly. Just to give you some statistics. Killorglin. Anyone been in Killorglin? It's on the Ring of Kerry, about 5.5 hour drive from here. Killorglin have the biggest pagan festival in Ireland called the Puck Festival once a year. Almost 1 million people descend on the village for a drunken party over that weekend. They have a bronze statue of a goat with a crown on its head in the village, permanent. Every year at the Puck Festival, they take a live goat from the fields. They get a virgin from the town to kiss the goat. They put the goat on a 30-foot pedestal, and they have a party. This is not the Congo. This is not the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, where you get your feet beaten, thrown into prison. There is freedom of speech where you can go and present the gospel. Do you know how many evangelical churches are in Killorglin? There isn't any. There isn't any. Kilrush. I was in Kilrush last week, right on the coast of Clare. Anyone been to Kilrush? Wow, one person. I'm amazed even one person's been to Kilrush. It's like It's a 40-minute drive down a lane. There's not even a good road till you get to this little village of Kurush. And in Kurush, I'd like you to pray for Brian, lovely, godly man. Every Thursday night, he pays to use a room in the local school, and he invites people for a prayer meeting and Bible study. I was there with him. He had 8 people at it. I was so honored and so blessed to be there, to listen to their stories, to share the gospel with them, to pray with them. You see, sometimes we get so obsessed with the big. But how are we going to reach the big if we're not passionate about the small? God is in the detail. People say the devil's in the detail. God is in the detail. How are we going to reach 1 billion souls? 1 soul at a time. Make sure no one's left out. On our church planting strategies, how are you going to reach Kurush if your church planting strategy is, well, this is what you need. You need 40 volunteers and $50,000 in the bank. And that will help you start your church plant. In Kurush, 40 volunteers, 50,000 volunteers, that's £50,000. That's revival for them. Do you get what I'm saying? Now, me going one day isn't going to do it. What Brian's doing is just being available. Polystyrene cup with instant coffee and a rich tea biscuit and just loving the people in front of you is where you're going to make a difference. If we're going to be effective in planting churches around Ireland and around the world, we can't be obsessed with just the mega cities and the mega churches. We need to be doing it with ordinary people. Yes, give me an amen on that. So important. I've been given a little bit more time. Brian gave me a note, so I've now got 12 minutes. So thank you, Brian, for giving me that note. County Offaly. So if Ireland is the most unevangelized English-speaking nation in the world, County Offaly is the most unevangelized county in Ireland. 80,000 people live in Offaly. At best, there are 3 evangelical churches. The biggest one, Cornerstone Slieve Bloom, about 100 people. By our own studies, and adding some folk in that live in Offaly but go to church outside of County Offaly, Offaly, of 80,000 people, when you listen to this, is about 0.4% evangelical. The Islamic Republic of Pakistan is 1.27. Cuba is 5. This is 3.5 hours away from where we're sitting right now, 4 hours from where we're sitting. I'm not jumping on, like, just on. Obviously, I've got a heart for Ireland. You see my passion in that. But what I'm saying is, like, whatever your calling is, whatever God has called you to do, it could be Belfast, it could be Ballymena, it could be Asia, whatever it is, get your divine assignment. Get on track with your divine assignment, and the anointing will flow through you for the glory of God, and the mission of God will multiply. That's how it works. What's your divine calling? When you get your divine calling, stay in your track. I will say it, pray in tongues every day, and it will do you the world of good, and it will keep you on your track for the mission of God. Part 3, challenges of creative access ministry. These next sessions are shorter, so don't panic. Creative access ministries is Christians using their professions to engage in mission evangelism and discipleship. That's altogether brilliant. But why is this so important? Well, it is important in places like the 1040 window, where if you apply for an R1 religious visa because I want to go to Pakistan and plant a church, you're not going to get accepted. But if you go to Pakistan and you're going to be in a construction business or you're going to be teaching English in a school, highly likely. China is the same. If you're going to China but you're going to teach English, highly likely that you will get a visa. Hudson Taylor, the great-great-grandson, tells a story of going a number of years ago to China. He's back and forward regularly, still involved in a mission globally. But he goes to China, and he's teaching medical students in a medical college. He's bringing medical students to work in a hospital in China. He's bringing medical students to work in a hospital in China. So they're all, like, from the West. And the director of the hospital asks him a question. Of these 30 or 40 students that you're bringing here, are they all Christian? What does Hudson say at that moment? What does he say? Well, he has to be true and honest. He said, Yes, they are. And the director of the hospital said, that's good. That's good. He knows they won't get a visa to go in there as a missionary. But he knows that if they come in there to do this like bivocational work, that they can use that moment and opportunity for the mission of God. Creative access ministry is what I said. Christians can visualize various professions, platforms to go into a country to work and to witness. And let me make a little observation on creative access ministries. Next slide over here is that the danger that comes with CAM, creative access ministries, both at home and overseas. Over the past 20 years, I have noted a worrying trend where we dilute evangelism into something that's not, causing disastrous consequences all around. Let's remember what evangelism is: communicating the gospel. It is not food bank or digging water wells or building schools. Now, that might provoke you a little bit today, but it's important that we understand bivocational ministry is excellent and important. But what you can't do is spend your whole time in a 10:40 window giving people food, digging wells, but never telling people about Christ. Come on, are you with me? And it's the same local with our food banks. How much money has the church invested in the food banks? And we're feeding lots of people, but we're not winning souls. We're not leading people into a personal relationship with Jesus. And we have diluted the mission of God. R.T. Kendall, I know you know him, Jeff. R.T. Kendall, in conversation with me, said this: I remember the days when missionaries used to come back from the 10:40 window and they would tell the stories of people coming to Christ. Now they come back and they tell you about the orphanage they built, the English that they're teaching. But I don't see an awful lot of people being won for Jesus. Let's be gospel-centric in our mission. Not all mission is evangelism. Mission, let me illustrate this, very important. Think NASA. Everybody heard of NASA? NASA sent rockets up. When they send a rocket up into space, they put a payload on the rocket. It might be a satellite dish to spy on Pastor Brown. It might be a satellite dish that's providing something else. They might be bringing some resources to the space station. They have got lots of payloads on the rocket. Does that make sense? Mission is the church going out, and on that rocket, you could have food bank. You could have digging water wells. You could have building orphanages, but you must have the gospel. Because if you don't have the gospel, then what you're in danger of is that mission becomes humanitarian aid. And much as it's noble and noteworthy, you don't need to be a Christian to do humanitarian aid. I know some amazing people. I know some great friends in the fire service. I served there for 16 years. And they will be the first one to jump on a flight to help in an earthquake in Turkey or wherever it might be. They're not Christians, just good people. Good people will give money to people. Good people will love people. But we are not like everybody else. We are a chosen generation. We are a royal priesthood. We are a peculiar people. So let's make sure we keep the main thing, the main thing. Part four. I got seven, but these last ones are just footnotes. Globalization. So in the world that we live in today, let's look at the cultural trends of what is happening in urbanization and globalization. Urbanization is basically what has happened I'm just checking the numbers here. I'll jump over one. Since 2007, people are moving towards cities more all around the world. Now you have mega cities. Before 2007, most of the population of the world lived in rural areas. Now they live mostly in cities. So that gives us unique opportunities in how we present the gospel to others, doesn't it? But not at the expense of overlooking the need to reach the rural community. If we just get caught up in planting our churches in cities, having our conferences in cities, having our events in a big city, what are we saying to the people who are rural? And actually, globally, Hudson Taylor's study said that the majority of people that still live in rural areas are the elderly and children. So let's not focus just on cities and our evangelism. Next year, we're doing this Next 3 months, we're doing an outreach in Offaly. Every home will get a resource. Every school will get a resource. But then in March, we're having a conference. I'm holding a conference in two places. I could have held it in Belfast with Dr. John Andrews and Dublin with Dr. John Andrews. But I'm not. I'm going to hold it in Belfast. I'm going to hold it in Offaly. I don't think Offaly's ever had a Christian conference in the last 1,500 years. So we're going to have one. Why not? I want to put Offaly on the map. I want to change the story. The story you heard today of it being 0.4 evangelical, we can rip that up in Jesus' name this time next year. Amen. We're going to change the story. Where can you change the story? Where is your assignment? What's God called you to be? Some of the things you can be involved in. Mercy, recovery ministries and mercy ministries. You can pop that up on the screen there. So let's see some action. That's what my headline is here in part 7. Jump across there. Okay, hold that one up. Hold that back up. So in terms of global mission, here are some things here that we should consider. Short-term mission with long-term goals. Not just sending our kids to Romania to help build a fence and come home, and that's it. Or not even to send a mission team to the Republic of Ireland for 1 week and see people respond to the gospel on the street because you've got a snappy little resource to do that. It's like, what's the long term? What's the long term? Plant indigenous churches. That means churches that are culturally relevant to the culture around them. So when Hillsong's arrived in Paris some years ago, it didn't work. Why did it not work? Because culturally, that doesn't work for French people. Work for people who are non-French, but for French people, Sunday is a big family day. You can't take the French people on a Sunday, put the kids in this room, and the youth in this room, and all the big people stay in here. Because culturally, that's their big day where they stay together as a family. So that's what it means to be smart and how we engage. Contend in prayer. Educate and rewire, beg your pardon for my typo, our congregations towards gospel and mission. Support existing churches, missionaries that are on the front line. Who's already doing it? That's, again, another challenge we have. The church starts something new, people throw money at it. Try and support something that's existing, not so much. That's not healthy. There are wonderful organizations around the world, I could mention many of them, who have been active and fruitful in the mission of God in a 1040 window and elsewhere. What can we be doing intentionally to rewire our congregations to support them? Support and create entrepreneurial opportunities. So it's like, not just, I was in Moldova. Here's a little example of this. I went to Moldova a couple of years ago. So I'm preaching North Moldova, like the places nobody goes. These are villages that have never heard the gospel. We went to one village, 16 families. They have a cow in the field in the middle. One family keeps bees. One family grows corn. One family keeps water rats. And they all share that food together. Now, how do we keep something sustainable in there? Well, my interpreter from Moldova, he was 22 years of age. I said to him, "You're a really good evangelist. Like, you should be doing this, not me." And he said, "Oh, thank you." I said, "Do you have a plan for that?" He said, "Yes, sir, I do." I said, "What's your plan?" He said, "Well, last year I went to London for a year and I studied and I worked. I studied English to make sure my English was really good. And I worked very hard to save up as much money as I can. And I came home and I bought 4,000 walnut trees. And 5 years from now, I'll get my first harvest off the walnut trees. And I've worked out 5 years from now, I can step into full-time ministry and I will never, ever have to ask anyone for a dollar. It will all come from the fruit of that entrepreneurial spark of walnut trees." Amazing. So if we can do that, if we can be entrepreneurial in multiplying the mission of God. Support. Who is your church sending out into this end time harvest? Who is your church sending out into this end time harvest, both local and overseas? It's now 11:41. I would love to just pray with you, pray over you, just as we close this session. Would you please stand with me? you're comfortable, just to lift your hands. And pray the scariest prayer you can ever pray. It's two words. Use me. Use me, Lord. In this great end time harvest, use me. In the commission and mission of God, both at home and overseas, use me. Like you used Hudson Taylor, use me. Like you used Henry Grattan Guinness, use me. Like you're using Brian in Kilrush in County Clare, use me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Love you. Shalom, shalom.
Awesome, Mitch. Praise God. We're going to break, but just 1 minute. Praise God. Guys, think about the south of Ireland. I put on our church overhead the other day, a picture of the south of Ireland and also one of Scotland. And I just showed all the airports, the small little general aviation airports that you can fly into. 20 in Southern Ireland, 20 in Scotland makes it really, really easy to access some of these areas, you know, where people just aren't going. Hallelujah. And that is just phenomenal. We've got to increase our vision. Amen. Absolutely increase our vision. We're going to do it. We got to take ownership. Amen. Of the British Isles, Ireland, Southern Ireland. We got to take ownership in Jesus' name. Man, enjoy your break. We got 15 minutes here. It could be a bit longer, but just to keep schedule, please, 15 minutes. You want us to be timekeeping, and we'll ask you to do the same. Thank you.